Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let us start with the journey. So my topic today is anemia in elderly patients. Just give me 2 minutes so that I can configure about the presentation. Yes, that's good. Yes, it's just opposite of what we have heard till now. And basically, it's a very common one in clinical practice. And when we encounter our clinical day-to-day practice, we see that several of our geriatric population comes with anemia, and which is quite frequently diagnosed in older individuals and is a key indicator for various reactive and clonal conditions. The prevalence of anemia at older age is increasing and is mainly attributable to more frequently applied diagnostic and demographic changes in our society. The increased incidence of anemia with aging has led to a speculation that lower hemoglobin level may be a normal consequence of aging. However, there are at least two reasons for considering anemia in elderly as a sign of disease rather than a senescent presentation of the old age. First, the most older people maintain a normal red cell count, hemoglobin and hematocrit level throughout in their life. Second, in most elderly patients, an underlying cause of anemia is found for hemoglobin level that is less than 12 grams per deciliter. The etiology of the anemia at the older age is complex and ranges from bone marrow failure syndromes to chronic kidney disease, and from nutritional deficiencies to inflammatory process leading to inflammaging and immunosenescence at the old age. Now, the prevalence of the anemia is increasing in the old age, reaching to a prevalence of about 17% in the cohort of older patients more than 65 years of age. Improved diagnostic and demographic changes in our societies have resulted in an increase in the incidence and prevalence of anemia in the past decades. We are having more and more geriatric populations in our society, so this type of anemia is regularly increasing. In fact, many underlying disorders such as myelodysplastic syndrome, blood dysplasia, CKD, cancers, and certain gastrointestinal diseases develop more frequently at the old age, and they are the sole cause of anemia in many patients with different etiologies may act together. So multimorbidity is basically a presenting feature almost more than 70 to 80% of the patient and contribute to the development of anemia in the older age groups. Now, epidemiology of anemia in the senior adults is like this. Anemia in the older persons is common and relevant, that's posing a new challenges of healthcare system. So when we address our primary care physicians, we see that many of them encounter these types of anemia worldwide, and the larger prospective studies, registry studies like the Calgary Registry, have revealed an overall prevalence of anemia ranging from 10% to 24% in the older individual. And the senior adults admitted to the hospital are more frequently affected by anemia by around 40%, and the prevalence is even higher, 47% in the nursing home residents. Now, as you can see from this graph, this graph depicts the increased incidence and the prevalence of the anemia in the older age group, and you can see the graph is steeper for the male patients, and then these graphs become more steeper for the octogenarian people, and those people who are more than 80 years old, actually they have around 50% of them suffer from anemia, and the frequency of having anemia is more in men than in women, and the increased prevalence of anemia is defined by WHO, that is the hemoglobin level less than 12 gram per deciliter in women and 13 gram per deciliter in women with advanced age cohort that was detected over several thousand present in university hospitals, inpatients and outpatient patients, and that was documented worldwide. Now, let us take a case. Mr. S. Roy, 67-year-old male patient, came to my clinic with fatigue, shortness of breath, NIVH class 3, nocturia, intractable cough, and that is not responding to the antibiotic, and bipedal pitting edema, pallor, and bivasal Graves and JVP. So surely he was having signs of heart failure, and his weight was 63 kg and blood pressure was 100/70. This is the initial investigation report that was present for that person, Mr. Roy. His hemoglobin level was 7.2, serum iron was 60, so it was borderline. TIBC was 360, was slightly low. Fasting saturation was around 15. It was also in the borderline range. Ferritin was 90, so it was slightly low as well. The chest X-ray showed cardiomegaly bilateral pleural effusion. Echocardiography had a reduced ejection fraction of 34% with global hypokinesia, and the liver function was within normal limit without any features of transaminitis. And the renal parameters was normal. He had moderate proteinuria with urine albumin creatinine ratio around 270. So in the range of borderline microalbuminuria as well. His fasting blood sugar and PP blood sugar was high. HbA1c was 10, so he was having a uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. Mild hyponatremia was detected, and maybe due to dilutional effect as well. NT-proBNP was very high, and the CT coronary angio revealed triple vessel disease. So what is the definition of anemia at older age? So this person, Mr. Roy, who has came with a 7.2 hemoglobin, is definitely anemic. But a World Health Organization threshold that was established in 1968 for persons more than 65 years old defines anemia that hemoglobin level less than 13 in men and 12 in women, as we have already stated. However, hemoglobin level declines with age and are distinct in different ethnic groups. So far, we have seen that the African American people have lesser hemoglobin levels in the older age than the Caucasians, and the WHO definition anemia has applied in the majority of studies in the older age, and that actually does not include all the parameters that must be there. So there are some unresolved issues regarding the WHO criteria, and it was just done mainly on patients who are more than 50 year old, not adequately represented by more than 65 year old patient, and the number of the subject that was taken into account was small. So in 2006, Butler et al. Used two large databases, and one from the Scripps-Kaiser database, another from the ENHANCE database, which include more than 11,000 patients, and among them, 1,566 patients were more than 70 years old. And these databases has found that the anemia should be redefined, and the WHO criteria is absolutely not perfect. Some geriatric authorities have recently proposed that an equal hemoglobin threshold of 12 gram per deciliter must be defined as anemia in both genders. This is largely based on the long-standing notion that the hemoglobin decline with the age tends to be more pronounced in males than in females, which has been traditionally attributed to the progressive androgen deficiency. Now, this is the study result of the Butler et al. And you can see, they have divided the criteria among men and women and subdivided it among white and black, and proposed that the anemia in the men, white men, should be less than 13.7 and women should be less than around 12.2. So this is the several criteria that were used in several other studies as well, except World Health Organization and the Butler, Calleton and Andries et al. Was also included. And the results are almost similar, like between 13 and 12 for the male and for female patients. Now, what is the clinical presentation of this kind of anemia that present in the elderly population? These anemias are usually of insidious onset. I'm not telling that they cannot present acutely, but definitely many of them present insidiously. And many of the times the elderly patient adjusts their activities of their bodies and make their physiological adaptations such that, so that they can tolerate the conditions. And the typical symptoms of anemia such as fatigue, weakness, dyspnea are not specific, and in elderly patient tend to be attributed to the advancing age and also the other comorbidities like arthritis, presence of rheumatological disease or senescence. Pallor is a helpful diagnostic clue, but due to discoloration of the skin and the dark skin people, many times difficult to detect, and conjunctival pallor is a reliable sign, and that should be looked for in case of older adults. Association with multiple comorbidities, including CHF, as we have stated in this case, dementia, apathy makes the nutritional anemia more likely for these patients. Now, what is the association between anemia and the mortality in older adults? As we have seen in many epidemiological studies, that there is increased mortality associated with developing anemia, and that is due to increased muscular fragility decreased physical performance and reduced muscle strength and increased risk of falls. These are called the geriatric giants, which actually take a toll on the old age patient, and that also include the cognitive decline and the dementia. Increased risk of hospitalization and longer hospital stay, and even with an increased mortality risk associated with all these conditions. Other important condition that we have to consider is the presence of chronic kidney disease. So this is basically the mortality graph, curve of mortality. As you can see, that those patients between the range of 13 to 16 hemoglobin level, their mortality level is pretty lower. But when the hemoglobin level becomes less than 12, the chances of mortality increases by threefold in older populations. These are the several other studies that have clearly stated this idea. And the ENHANCE study and also the ENCHANTI study has shown that anemia is associated with disability, poorer physical performance, lower muscle strength, even in adjusted analysis, including comorbidities, renal function, and inflammatory marker. So not only the associated comorbidity, but anemia, anemia per se is a separate predictive parameter for development of increased mortality in older aged patients. Now, increased morbidity is associated with community dwelling older patient. They have a decreased quality of life, and that also increases their fatigue, depression, dementia, and delirium, and overall the confusion increases, and that actually increases a vicious cycle where the overall nutritional intake also decreases, and in turn, ultimately, anemia due to some other cause becomes a nutritional anemia, and ultimately the patient goes into a state of immobility and decubitus ulcer, and which in turn again increases the chances of developing anemia, and ultimately the patient succumbs to that. Now, the mechanisms of anemia in older patients is very complex, but the three important organs that are associated with it are kidney, reticuloendothelial system, and liver. Increased inflammation ultimately leads to a state of erythropoietin resistance to the bone marrow. Increased production of cytokines like interleukin-6, interleukin-2, TNF-alpha, and fibroblast growth factor beta all leads to production of decreased erythropoiesis and ultimately causes bone marrow depression. And in the liver, they have increased production of hepcidin due to presence of increased inflammation, ultimately leads to reduced absorption of the iron from the gut and as well as a reduced production of the blood cells in the bone marrow. These are the most common causes of anemia in elderly. Anemia of chronic disease, they constitute about 30 to 45% of the patients. Iron deficiency anemia comes next with 15 to 30% of the patient. Post-hemorrhagic anemia up to 5 to 10% of the patients. Vitamin B12 deficiency, 5 to 10%. Leukemia and other blood dysplasias constitute 5%. MDS comes to 5%, and we have no identifiable cause of 15 to 25% of the patient, but the number of no identifiable cause or unexplained anemia causes are really decreasing with advent of newer diagnostic modalities and with sharpening of our laboratory tools. Now, this is a big list, which actually states other causes or other associated factors with anemia in older age. I'll not be able to state everything, but I'll try to emphasize some diseases which are really common, like say rheumatoid arthritis and polymyalgia rheumatica, very common condition. Chronic hepatitis and myelitis, osteomyelitis are also very common. Now, presence of gastrointestinal bleeding is a very important cause of anemia in older age group. And sometimes they have a specific etiology for that. Sometimes they have diffuse GI bleeding that is associated with drugs or other medicines that conglomerate on older peoples. And chronic non-mechanical and mechanical hemolysis is also responsible for those patients who have been transplanted with the heart valves. And nutritional anemia and drug-induced anemia due to chemotherapy, anti-metabolites, and toxic drugs are also responsible for the development of anemia in the older age. Now, as we have already stated, anemia of inflammation is the most common cause, and how to diagnose anemia of inflammation, because this is a specifically confusing entity. And we have to consider and we have to differentiate this anemia from anemia of iron deficiency. Now, these are the cutoff values that has been used in several studies, and you can see if the serum ferritin is more than 100, it usually signifies anemia of inflammation. There are several other parameters as well, like say TIBC, serum iron and transferrin saturations. And all these anemia of inflammations are due to slow growing chronic infections like tuberculosis, infective endocarditis or UTIs or fungus infection, or due to rheumatological conditions like osteoarthritis, rheumatoid arthritis or collagen vascular disease or PMDM. Now IDAs, as we have seen, the GI tract is the most common cause of causing iron deficiency anemia in the senescent people. Upper GI is responsible for the 20 to 40% of the cases. Lower GI is responsible for the 15 to 30% of the cases. And both upper and lower GI are responsible for the 1 to 15% cases. The about 10 to 40% cases, no source is found. And that is mainly due to the presence of bleeding from the small gut where the scopes cannot approach. And among all this, about 50% of this 40% is due to ulcer or pathology in the Meckel's diverticulum or diverticulosis. And capsule endoscopy actually comes to play whenever we want to diagnose this type of cases. Now, there are some newer parameters to detect iron deficiency or subclinical iron deficiency. When we are in confusion, we'll definitely discuss about it in near future. The increased soluble transferrin receptor or STFR is a very important parameter. Increased STFR ferritin ratio, elevated RBC zinc protoporphyrin level to more than 80, because a zinc protoporphyrin level increases when there is reduced hematopoiesis due to iron deficiency. So increased RBC zinc protoporphyrin is an important cause. Reticulocyte hemoglobin content and also the bone marrow iron stain. These are the parameters that we also keep in mind when diagnosing the iron deficiency anemia. Now, this is a flowchart basically to diagnose a cause of microcytic or normocytic anemia, that is that we get in iron deficiency or anemia of chronic disease. When the serum ferritin level is relatively low, less than 15, it actually includes iron deficiency anemia as the cause. And if it is elevated more than 100, that actually rules out iron deficiency anemia. And we have to consider other causes like congenital hemoglobinopathies. About the mid-range populations, those who are between the 46 to 100, we have to determine the serum transferrin receptor ferritin complex index, where the index is more than 1.5, that actually signifies the iron deficiency, and iron replacement is required for those patients. And if it is less than 1.5, we have to detect if it is due to chronic kidney disease or not by doing a GFR. And if it is more than, GFR is more than 60, and that is the entity of anemia of unexplained origin. We'll discuss it afterwards. Now, how to determine anemia of inflammation and anemia of iron deficiency that sometimes overlap? So that is the area where we have to do a serum soluble transferrin receptor. For those patients who have low soluble transferrin receptor, we know that is anemia of chronic disease or anemia of inflammation. Those who have high soluble transferrin receptor, we know that is iron deficiency anemia. And for those patients who have indeterminate soluble transferrin receptor, only way to diagnose the iron deficiency, the cause of anemia, is doing a bone marrow examination and to see for the iron store with a Prussian blue stain. And the iron stores are absent, we diagnose with iron deficiency anemia for certain. And if iron doses are plenty, the anemia of chronic disease is the most common cause. Now, these are the key recommendations for practice. A low serum ferritin level is associated with diagnosis of iron deficiency anemia. Older patients with suspected iron deficiency anemia should undergo an endoscopy to evaluate for occult gastrointestinal malignancy, and low dose formulation of iron in the form of 15 mg of elemental iron can be very effective in the treating the suspected iron deficiency, because giving high dose actually saturates the hepcidin level. Now, these are the different types of parenteral iron preparations that the physicians sometimes use, because they face challenge for managing the iron deficiency anemia with oral iron preparation. When a patient's iron loss exceeds the maximum amount of iron that is given in the gut because of the chronic blood loss, and that actually produces a condition where we faces a scenario where except giving parenteral preparation of the iron, we don't have any other options to have. So ferric carboxymaltose, ferric gluconate, ferumoxytol, iron dextran, and iron sucrose are the different types of preparation that can be given according to the dose for correction of these types of anemia. Now, this is the formula to replenish the iron. We have to basically calculate out the...
Dr. Sagnik, sorry to interrupt you here. Your time is already over.
Okay, so
you can I'll just give a one, two message, important message, which you want to
So there are some other causes as well, vitamin B12 deficiency and folate deficiency, where we have to determine about the subclinical vitamin B12 deficiencies as well by the determination of the methylmethylphenolic acid and the homocysteine level. Now, this is what happens with Mr. Roy. Mr. Roy responded suboptimally with oral and parenteral iron therapy. And these are the causes of unexplained anemia in elderly, and where we can see that there are full spectrum of MDS and myeloma and related other conditions that can cause anemia in all those patients with the full spectrum of anemia. These are the indications of the bone marrow aspirations for anemic patients. As you can see, pancytopenia, monoclonal gammopathy, suspicion of MDS, etc. And we have to do manage all these anemias with a multidisciplinary approach, and with these are the newer drug that is lexaptepid and several other like PRS18 that are coming for any treatment of anemia in elderly patients. Now, ultimately, Mr. Roy was diagnosed with amyloidosis because he had a bone marrow positivity, which is a very common complication as anemia, as a comorbidity associated with it. And we have to refer our patients accordingly. We see that the patient is having multimodal problems. The key message is that anemia in elderly is not due to aging and is mostly due to underlying disease conditions. So we have to be very patient, and we have to search for the causes in elderly patients, and we don't have to stop investigating them as they have become older. Thank you.